Ravi. The eyes are windows to the world, Amma always says. When I was little, she would look into my eyes and tell me they were bright and sparkling, like my mind. That was before Dr. Batra discovered that I could hardly see. In kindergarten, I had a serious copying problem. I could never copy anything correctly from the board. While reading a book, I had to stick my face so close to the page that my teacher, Miss Venkat, suspected that I had some serious reading issues. When she called my mother in to tell her to get me assessed, Amma had cried. She couldn't stand that they were questioning my intelligence. It was Dr. Batra who figured out that the problem was with my eyesight. Now I wear glasses. The power of my lens is 13, and I can see the world clearly. Miss Frost gives me a book called Fun with Phonics and tells me to read along with the recording of the first story. There is a picture of letters dressed up in funny clothes on the cover. This is ridiculous. Does she think I'm a baby? I pretend to be listening to the story, but instead I turn down the volume and shift the headphones away from my ears so that I can hear what Miss Frost and Bigfoot are saying. He is talking to her about candy. I hear footsteps and people laughing out in the corridor. I recognize Dylan's voice. Last one in line gets a wedgie, he shouts. Why must I be stuck in here listening to baby stories when I could be racing off to eat lunch with my new friend, Dylan Samreen? I pull off the headphones and stand up. I've listened to the story, ma'am. Please, can I go now? I ask, but Miss Frost tells me to sit down and eat my lunch. Will I be trapped here forever like Bud Caldwell was trapped in the shed with the angry bees? I open my tiffin box and slowly unfold my napkin. How sad Amma would be if she could see me now. No wonder Bigfoot made such a fuss when Mrs. Beam called on him earlier to read aloud. He probably doesn't know how to read a word. I notice the fat red book sitting on a shelf nearby and realize what I must do. I finish my vegetable biryani in a few bites. Miss Frost is still busy with Bigfoot, so she doesn't notice me get up and pull the heavy dictionary down from the shelf. I lay it on the table, open it up to the section marked A, then run my finger down the page. Askew, assess, yes, there it is, assimilate. I narrow my eyes and slowly read out the words. To take in, digest, incorporate. Ha, I knew it, I whisper, smiling to myself and shaking my head from side to side. I will show Mrs. Beam this page, and she will have no choice but to admit defeat. I'll announce her mistake in front of the whole class, pump my fist, and take a bow. How sweet my victory will taste. In the meantime, I eavesdrop and find that Bigfoot is talking on and on about candy. He never says a word in class, but here he can't stop talking about chocolate and peanuts. Will it never end? I look at the dictionary one last time, just to be doubly sure, running my finger along under the words, this time very, very slowly. I want to make sure I have not missed anything. Take in, digest, incorporate. I bend my head closer. There is something else. To integrate, to fit in. My finger freezes. Can my eyes be fooling me? No, thanks to Dr. Batra, I can see perfectly well. I read it again. To integrate, to fit in. I close the dictionary and quickly pull my social studies book out of my backpack, turning to chapter 1. In this context, Mrs. Beam had said. I read the passage and my heart feels heavy. Consuming and incorporate nutrients has nothing to do with Native Americans in New Jersey in the 1700s. Just a minute ago, I had wanted to 1. Announce my victory, 2. Pump my fist, 3. Take a bow. But instead, this is how I feel. 1. Embarrassed, 2. Ashamed, 3. Defeated. Miss Frost comes and sits down next to me. I'm sorry to keep you waiting, she said. But I know you're eager to go get back to class, but I thought it might be a good idea for us to have a little chat. What is there to talk about? The taste of victory is gone. All I want is to dig a deep hole and hide my head in it forever. I'm here to help you in any way I can, says Miss Frost. We have lots of ESL material here in the resource room. ESL, I say? English as a second language, she explains. Mrs. B mentioned that she and some of the children have been having difficulty understanding you because of your accent. I hang my head. English is not my second language. It is my first. My English is much better than my Tamil. Mop Top doesn't even know me, and now she is criticizing the way I speak? And how difficult this must be for you, she tells me. A new school in a new country. Maybe it would help to speak with Mr. Garfinkel, our guidance counselor. He's very easy to talk to. I feel like I'm suffocating. Now I'm in need of some kind of counseling, too. Please, I whisper, can I just go back to my classroom? Of course, she says and pats my hand. Mrs. Beam should be back in her classroom by now. I'm sure she won't mind if you sit quietly and read until the others have come back from lunch. I nod my head, grateful that my torture is finally coming to an end. Then I quickly stuff my tiffin box and social studies book back in my backpack before Miss Frost can change her mind about letting me go. Bigfoot is looking at a magazine and doesn't even look up as I walk past. Would you like an M&M for the road? Miss Frost asks me, holding out a big bowl full of colored candies. Amma doesn't like me to eat sweets, but I don't want to be rude, so I take a candy, a blue one, and put it in my pocket as I prepare myself for the long walk back. Miss Frost and I walk down the corridor together. When we reach room 506, she turns to me. How about we meet again next week, she says, once you've had a bit more time to settle in. I reach to open the door, but Miss Frost puts her hand on my shoulder. Before you go, can I tell you something? I think you've assumed something about Joe that isn't true. You and he could easily be friends. I shake my head no. Why should I be his friend after what he did to me? This morning in class, he tripped me on purpose with his foot and nearly broke my glasses, I say. That doesn't sound like the Joe I know, says Miss Frost. Dylan saw him do it, I tell her. He told me. Miss Frost bites her lip and then says, I wasn't there. But if he tripped you, he owes you an apology. And you owe him an apology as well, for implying that he might not be as smart as you are. Just because Joe needs some help doesn't mean he isn't bright. You shouldn't assume things about a person before you know who they really are. People are making assumptions about me, too, I point out. They think I can't speak English or do math, but that's not true. Miss Frost nods her head. You see, she says, assumptions are often wrong. She tells me to remember that. Chapter 16, Joe. When Miss Frost comes back to the resource room, she's carrying a tray with three hamburgers on it, one for her and two for me. Did anything happen in class this morning that I should know about, Joe? She asks, tearing open a package of ketchup with her teeth and carefully squeezing a squiggly red line onto the top half of her bun. I'm already done with my first hamburger and about to start in on the second. I should have asked for three. I spazzed out a little when Mrs. Beam asked me to read, I say. Did you tell her about my APD? Miss Frost nods. I reach for a carton of chocolate milk and try to open the spout, but the paper keeps ripping. Miss Frost takes it from me and uses her fingernail to pull open the milk. Then she hands it back. I was wondering if anything happened with Ravi in class this morning, she says. It's Ravi, I say. And Dylan tripped him right after he did some crazy-looking math problem on the board. Is that what you mean? He seems to think that you were the one who tripped him. I shake my head. I guess maybe he's not as smart as he thinks he is, I say. After school gets out, my mom is sitting in the car waiting for me. We go through the same routine as the day before. She tries to convince me to let her give me a ride home, and I tell her I'd rather walk. I walk to school in the morning, too. I don't get mad that often, but when I do, I always stay mad for a while. I have a couple of bucks in my pocket, so I stop at the mini mart on the corner to buy a snack. I had been planning to get a bagel and cream cheese, but instead I decide to buy a king-size bag of peanut M&Ms. Ever since I saw Ravi take that double blue one out of the bowl, it's been bugging me that I didn't find it first. I pay for the M&Ms and rip open the pack. Out of 22, there are 5 blues, but no doubles. I eat them slowly, sucking off the layers, trying to make them last the whole way home. When I finally walk in the door, Mimi comes running. She rolls over on her back, and I give her a good belly scratch. Mom's out in the kitchen, and from the smell of things, I'm pretty sure she's making pork roast and scalloped potatoes. It's going to be hard to stay mad at her if she keeps this up. Joey, Mom calls. Is that you? Yeah, I call back. She comes out of the kitchen drying her hands on a dish towel. Hungry? She asks. My head tells me to go upstairs, but my stomach tells me where there's pork roast and scalloped potatoes, there might be apple crisp, too. I'm starving, I say. Dinner won't be ready for another hour, but I just took a crisp out of the oven. You want some? Boy, do I. But between last night with the meatloaf and now this, I don't want her to think I'm a pushover. I'm still mad at you, I tell her. I know, she says. I follow her out into the kitchen where she dishes up a big bowl of warm apple crisp. Ice cream, she asks. I nod, and she puts a scoop of vanilla on top of the crisp. Perfect. I take a bite and close my eyes, letting the taste explode in my mouth like fireworks. Are you ever going to forgive me, she asks. Eventually, I tell her. She gets busy washing lettuce. I'm glad she doesn't ask me about my day. I keep thinking about what Ravi said and the way he pointed his finger at me. Even apple crisp can't take the edge off that. More? Asks Mom. No thanks, I say, handing her the empty bowl. I'm good.